proclaiming the gospel throughout the world. Bill Winston Ministries is bringing lost souls to Jesus Christ and teaching them how to walk in a victorious life. We invite you to receive all the blessings that God has for your life. Bill Winston Ministries presents The Believer's Walk of Faith.
Hello, I'm Bill Winston, and welcome to another program. The program that you're watching is called The Believer's Walk of Faith, where we walk by faith and not by sight. We have an exciting program for you today. We're teaching on receiving our inheritance. Now, this is a teaching that I believe every believer must know about. This is something that God has today for us and for us to really manifest the sons of God as God has intended for this whole earth to come out of the places of bondage where it is. We're going to have to know this particular teaching, how to receive our inheritance. Now, one of the things about this particular teaching that you're going to see today, we're talking about building ourselves up. In other words, in Acts chapter 20 and verse 32, Paul said it this way, "I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among all them that are sanctified." Now, what is he saying? For us to really receive what God has for us, we have to be built up. In other words, we have to come off of baby food and come off of all the fleshly things and go into the spirit. Because when you're moving in the spirit, you have to move beyond your five physical senses. The Bible says that we in our own natural abilities cannot receive the kingdom of God. In other words, the kingdom of flesh and blood cannot receive the kingdom. You have to receive it with the heart, with the spirit. And so for us to do that, you got to grow up. So this teaching is talking about how to grow up and some of the things that have been inhibiting us or keeping us from developing as mature Christians. Get your Bibles and pencils and papers ready. Let's go into it. It's called Receiving Our Inheritance.
Once you're born again, there is an inheritance for you, but will not be delivered unto you beyond your level of growth. Now, let's go to Acts chapter 20 one more time, please. Are you with me? Verse 32. "And now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to do what to you? Build you what? Up and give you what? An inheritance." Keep going. "Among all them which are sanctified." So before I get the inheritance, I've got to be what? Built up. And the primary thing that God uses to build you up with is the word of God. So he uses his word to build you up. Now here's what it says over in the Gospels. "Man shall not live by what? Bread alone, but by what? Every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God." So you do not live by natural food alone, but you need some spiritual food. And the spiritual food that you need comes primarily from the word of God. Say amen to that. So for you to live and be strong in your spirit, you need to be built up. And you got to be built up with the word of God. So let's say you're not getting any spiritual food. Now, the only other food that you're getting is natural. And what is the natural food doing? It's strengthening the flesh. So now my flesh is strong and my spirit is weak. No wonder I keep doing what I don't want to do, because I have no resistance on the inside to keep me from making that step that my flesh wants to make. Are you following what I'm saying? So every day you should have a little devotional. You should have a little book. It tells you two or three scriptures. And just give your spirit something that your spirit can say, thank you, Jesus. Your spirit, because your spirit is hungry for the word of God, just like your flesh is hungry for something to eat. So why do we go on fast? We don't go on fast to move God. We go on fast to move our flesh. Our flesh is blocking the way to our inheritance. Now, do you follow what I'm saying? So now we've got to grow up. Now, there are three stages in this growing up. So let me just show you this. Are y'all with me here? See, the quality of your intake determines the strength of your output. Say amen to that. It said Jesus had fasted 40 days, and then he came back in the power of the Spirit. And the devil tempted him and said, hey, if you bow down to me, all this will be yours. Jesus wouldn't have to deal with it. He said, get thee behind me, you rascal, you. I'm saying that when you're strong in your spirit, you can resist sin. You can resist the things of the devil. But what does he try to do? He tries to keep you out of the word. He tries to keep you from hearing a man of God that's going to speak strength into your spirit. He tries to keep you from church service on Wednesday night. But I'm telling you, this is a new day for you. And God is coming in to your life like never before. You're about to move up to another level and dominate the spirit of the world, and you will be manifesting the sons of God. It's starting right now. Whatever kind of word you're getting is going to be a reflection of the ability that you're going to have to dominate in this earth. Are you following what I'm saying? First, the natural man. The natural man. Turn to Ephesians, and Ephesians chapter 2, the natural man. Three types of man. First, the natural man. Look at verse 1. And you have he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince, the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we had our conversation in times past in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of our flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in mercy, for with his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath he quickened us together with Christ. By grace are you saved. Now I want to read that same thing out of the Amplified, and here's what it says in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 1. And you, he made alive when you were dead and slain by your trespasses and sins, in which at one time you walked habitually, and you were following the course and fashions of this world. You were under the sway of the tendency of this present age, following the prince of the power of the air. You were obedient to and under the control of demon spirit that still constantly work in the sons of disobedience, the careless, the rebellious, and the unbelieving who go against the purposes of God. Among these, we, as well as you, once lived and conducted our lives in the passions of our flesh, our behavior governed by our corrupt and sensual nature, obeying the impulses of the flesh and the thoughts of the mind, our cravings dictated by our senses and our dark imaginings. We were then by nature children of God's wrath and heirs of his indignation like the rest of mankind. That's where we came from. We came from a natural man. A natural man is still under the dictates of demon spirits. And that's why you and I, as believers, are not supposed to marry anyone that is an unbeliever. Hear what I'm saying? He said, be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Now, why is this? Because the unbeliever, as he said, unbeliever is under the control of his father. His father, her father, is the devil. And so, if you marry a person who is under the control of the devil and you bring them into a relationship or in your house, they might act good as long as you're courting, because the devil will let them act good so that he can gain access into your life. But once you bring them in, and then all of a sudden they get what they want, then they turn over one morning and say, ah, and all of a sudden from Dr. Jekyll to Mr. Hyde. I'm telling you right now, don't be yoked together with unbelievers. You say, well, Pastor, suppose I'm already married to somebody. The Bible has instructions for you of how to get that person converted over into the kingdom of God. I'm just saying right now that by nature we were children of wrath, but God, who is rich in mercy, wherewith his great love that he loved us, he transferred us from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of God's dear Son. So you are no longer natural, you are spiritual. Say amen to that. Well, Pastor, what if I do if I got this friend that he's real close to me? You know, we really getting close. And you know, he want me to bring him to church every day. Hey, wait a minute. If you feel that thing is getting away from you, let somebody else bring him to church. Tell him, God, I'm going to turn him over to you, because the devil don't send you nothing that you don't like. He knows what you like. Boy, he sure is fine, ain't he? Hey, boy, she sure, look at her hair. Look at them legs. He knows what you like, and you got to pop out of that, because you are no longer going to be led by your flesh. You're going to be led by the Word of God. Now, the next kind of man, the next kind of man, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, please, chapter 2, 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Now, notice, you're getting strong now. You might have had something going on with somebody, hey, that wasn't right, and now you're feeling strength, and you're feeling strength because I'm giving you the word, and part of the anointing is to strengthen your spirit to separate you from danger, to separate you from what is not holy, to separate you. I commend you to God unto a word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among all them that are separated, sanctified, Holy Ghost filled. I'm telling you, God's got some good stuff for you, and you are about to get it. Because what has, oh, have mercy. Look at verse 14 of chapter 2. But the natural man, watch this, receives not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are what to him? Foolishness to him. Neither can he what? Know them, because they are what? Spiritually discerned. Notice, a natural person thinks part of the Word of God is foolishness, especially the part about tithing. They said, what? You're going to give all your money to that church, 10% of your money? Are you crazy? Yeah, see, you know why? Because they are not in touch with God. They can't even receive the instructions of God, and they are still in the world under demonic control. So don't let nobody in your house tell you what you're going to do with your tithe except God. If God didn't say it, don't believe it. Because the enemy is out to try to swipe your blessing, and part of that blessing come for you getting connected up with the covenant by the tithe. Say amen to this. I'm preaching better than you saying amen right now. All right. Got quiet when I started talking about tithe. Okay. That's all right. I'm encouraged. The next way, the next place. Look at verse 1. Now, I'm saying this, that everybody doesn't want to receive this. See, if somebody doesn't want to receive this, let him go. I'm not talking to them. I'm talking to those who are chosen. I'm talking to those who are chosen. You know, everybody talking about heaven ain't going. I found folks, you know, folks can act saved. I remember when I act saved. Okay. Come on. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Have you got it? Verse 1. I, brethren, could not speak unto you as spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as the babes in Christ. Notice, a carnal person is a baby. So a natural person, when you're talking about a natural man, He's motivated by demons. He's never been recreated. He's never had the new birth. And it's not under the control of God. Now, God can come in and do some things through you to back them demons off their life. But I'm telling you right now, that's where the natural man is. Now, the carnal man is different, because the carnal man's been born again, but he's still governed by his physical senses. And that's why it's hard for God to trust him with anything. Because if he's governed by his physical senses, that means he's not walking by faith. Because you can't walk by your senses and walk by faith. You hear what I'm saying? And I remember this guy told me a story. He said this man, he was a homeless guy. God got him, brought him to church, got him born again. And then he gave him a job in his business. He had a business of selling equipment or something like that. And gave him a business. And after about 6 months, the guy did pretty good. He said, well, I'm going to go on vacation. It looked like the guy's good. I'm going to kind of leave him in charge of everything. He left the guy in charge, stayed away for 2 weeks, came back. Came to his business and nothing was there. God stole everything. Now what happened? He meant well, but he wasn't mature. He was still being led by his senses so the enemy could use him. He was born again. Oh, you've seen born again folks smoking cigarettes, so forth and so on. Now I'm just saying they're born again, but they're still led by their senses. Now, but the problem is God can't trust him with anything. Don't you know I had to come to a level of maturity before God would trust me with a mall this size? I had to come to a level of maturity before God would trust me with a bank? All right. Am I preaching all right here? So what am I saying? A carnal man has never developed or grown, and some remain there all their lives. And I tell you why they remain there. Because they have no desire to grow. Here's what they want. They want entertainment. As long as I'm running around, snotting all over the place and shouting and so forth, they're all right. But the moment I settle down and we get quiet and I start teaching, it's too quiet for them. They got to go. Well, that ain't exciting. It's not exciting because you're learning something. See, my job is to empower you. I can't keep doing all your praying. I can't keep doing all your believing. You're going to have to believe something yourself. Jesus turned to that bunch and said, where is your faith? And he wouldn't have asked them that if they weren't supposed to have been walking in it. I'm telling you, some of y'all got faith enough right now to move some stuff. I'm talking about to get houses debt-free and so forth. The problem is you haven't released it. You're still looking at me. You still want another sermon. You don't need another sermon. You need some teaching, and then you need to act on what you just heard. Say amen to that. Folks, I have to do stuff that looks strange to the mind. I have to go around the house. I walk around the house or point at a house, put my wallet on the table, point at it, put my checkbook up there. In the name of Jesus, I command $20,000 to come into that account right now. I'm talking about the check account that I want. I'm talking about do stuff, man. I'm a king. I can say things in this world. And when I decree it, Jesus said it shall be done for me. And you got to walk in that. You got to stop being so pretty and so sadiddy until you can't get crazy for God. Now, you know what I'm talking about. Man, you got to say some stuff. You got to point at that disease. You got to come in that house and say, every demon in here, get out. Because I'm gonna have some peace in here tonight. You follow what I'm saying? And we got to come out. See, that, well, I'm just shy. No, you're not. That's fear. And it has got you bound. And what you need to do is get rid of it. Whatever the devil says you can't do, do it. Whatever he says, don't say, say it. Say amen to this. Half of y'all are supposed to be prophesying and speaking things into people's lives and so forth. Get rid of this low self-esteem, low ceiling mentality and rise on up and seat together with him in heavenly places and decree a thing. I said, decree our thing. Make me want to run. All right. Verse 2. I fed you with milk and not with meat, but hitherto you are not able to bear it, neither yet are ye able. For ye are yet what? Carnal. For where there is among you envy, somebody drive up in a Rolls Royce or a Bentley, you should say, hey, that brother's saved. Praise God. God did for you. You ain't supposed to be, look at him now, he think he's something. No, you're supposed to be giving him something. Hey, man. Yeah, bro, bro, yeah. Man, yeah. Strife. Strife, divisions, all that. What is it? It says you walk as men. So what does the Amplified say on that? You walk as mere men. Mere men, you're not a mere person. You're not a. You're not just human. You are superhuman. Oh, yeah. What is a carnal person? Person been born again. He's a new creature, but has never developed or grown. And this person is still under the control of their physical senses. Their senses are still telling them where they stand with God. So they stay guilty all the time. They stay condemned all the time. They let them old tapes play all the time. And they follow them instead of following what God said. He said, you're a winner. He says he always causes you to triumph. Last place. Next is a spiritual man. What is a spiritual man? He is one who has gained ascendancy over his own body and over his physical senses. God governs this person through his word. He is the one who knows what belongs to him and takes it. He also knows who he or she is in Christ. He also knows the Holy Ghost. He also understands how God has given him his ability. He's no longer governed by his flesh, but he's only governed by the word. If the word didn't say it, so I'm here to tell you right now, God wants a quality to come into you that will determine a strong person being manifested through you. Whatever kind of word you're getting is a reflection of the ability that you're going to have. He says, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. You're no longer going to be controlled by the system. You're no longer going to be controlled by the circumstances. For now, the pedagogue has done his work in you. And now you're being presented faultless. You're being presented as a mature offspring. Now you're putting on that robe of righteousness. And now the Father trusts you, and he's about to turn everything over to you.